Hi, my name's JasonMorrell. The XLOOKUP function in Excel is taking over where VLOOKUP left off. Now, VLOOKUP's a great function, and it's used by many people across the world, but it does have some weaknesses. XLOOKUP pulls together the best parts of VLOOKUP, but also HLOOKUP, LOOKUP, MATCH, INDEX, and IFERROR. It's super powerful. In this video, I'm going to give you an express tour of the XLOOKUP function in Excel. Let me start by explaining what we have here on the screen. It's a simple table showing some tradies, what their trade is, where they're based, how old they are, their hourly rate, their hours worked. And what we want to do is, given a specific tradie, which is available on a drop-down list here, we want to create an XLOOKUP to retrieve their trade, and their state, and their age, and so on. You'll notice that name has been placed as the third column in the table, so in the middle of the table. And of course, if you're going to use a VLOOKUP, you would have to move that to the front of the table because VLOOKUP relies on the fact that the thing you're looking up is in the first column of a table. With XLOOKUP, it can be placed anywhere because the way you look at information is different. Let's start in the trade cell. And I'm going to type equals XLOOKUP, open the bracket. Now, if you look at the screen tip down here, there are six bits of information. And if you're familiar with VLOOKUP, there's only four. But a lot of these elements are very familiar, very similar. So the first one is the lookup value, which we're going to say is chip in just a moment. The lookup array and the return array refer to two different columns within the table. So the lookup array is going to be this list of names. The return array is going to be this list of trades. And then we have three optional arguments called if not found, match mode, and search mode. And I'll cover each of those as we go through this video. If you're not familiar with screen tips or don't like using screen tips, you can always, as soon as you've opened the bracket for the function, click the FX here, and it gives you a box with a complete breakdown. If you're on a Mac, it'll give you a sidebar over here with the same sort of layout, with explanations about everything. You'll see that three of the labels here are bold. They refer to the mandatory arguments, the three you have to put in, and then it's followed by the three optional arguments. It only displays the first two here, but there's a scroll bar over here to let you get down to the sixth one if you need to use that. Unfortunately, Microsoft doesn't let you expand the height or the width of this box. So seeing as this is already open, let me continue to use it. Going back to the top of the list, the first thing is the lookup value, which is the value in this yellow cell here, the name of the tradie. The lookup array is the list of names, and the return array is the list of trades. Both of those ranges have to be the same size, otherwise what you get might not make sense, or you might even get an error as a result. Also, just like VLOOKUP, the list of names has to be unique. So actually this is a dreadful example of what you'd use as a lookup. Generally speaking, you might have a tradie ID, or something unique that refers to each tradie, and then use that as the lookup. But this is just a demo, just go with it. Let's click OK, and you can see that Bricky has come back for chip, which is correct. And if we click this yellow box here and just choose a different tradie from the list, it brings back the appropriate tradie each time. But let's say that we typed in a value. So I've typed in chip with two P's here, which doesn't exist in our list. Now this cell has data validation behind it, and I've chosen the informational style, which lets this go through if I choose. As you can see, the result now is hash NA. It cannot find a match for chip with two P's. So the old-fashioned way of dealing with that is to wrap the whole VLOOKUP or whichever function you're using inside an if error function, and then say, look, if it's an error, display nothing. However, the XLOOKUP function has this if not found optional argument. So here, if I put a comma, what comes next is what I want displayed if it can't find a match or if any other kind of error occurs. So I'm going to say not found. We could say tradie not found or whatever wording you want to do. And when you press enter, that's now what gets displayed. If we choose a genuine tradie, you'll get the genuine result coming back. If I was to use XLOOKUP to retrieve the state and the age and all these other fields going across here, you'd have to either copy and then adapt each of these formulas accordingly. Now, obviously, the name range is the same all the way through. So you could make the D4 to D8 absolute, or you could even name this range beforehand and refer to the name. That's one way to get around that one. But the B4 to B8, which is the trade range, would have to change to C4 to C8 for the state, and E4 to E8 for the age, and so on. So while you can auto-fill this across, you need to make some changes in order for that XLOOKUP to work. However, let me show you something else. Here's another table where I've rejigged the order of the columns a little bit and also added an employee ID, a unique identifier, as the first column. But as you know, that could actually be anywhere in the table. But just for the sake of this next bit, it makes sense to put it on the left. What I'm going to do here in this first cell is to write an XLOOKUP as follows. So I start with equals XLOOKUP, open the brackets, my lookup value is this E02 just here, comma. The lookup array is our range of employee IDs, comma. The return array, and watch this, I'm going to choose the whole of this data range here. So normally, if you wanted to get the name back, you'd just choose the name range. And if you just wanted the trade back, you'd choose the trade range. But here, I'm going to choose the whole lot, because what XLOOKUP can do is to spill the results. And spill functions are a special category of functions within Excel that have this benefit. So rather than doing the old-fashioned way of writing one formula, auto-filling across, making changes to make that happen, and there are tricks you can use in there to make it happen, this is so much simpler. This is a proper database lookup now. If we choose a different employee ID, a different set of results come back based on the appropriate row in the table. Here's a third example, and I want to show you how approximate match works with XLOOKUP. With VLOOKUP, of course, and also HLOOKUP, you can do a exact match or an approximate match. Most of the time, of course, it's exact match. But approximate match, if you can't find an exact value, will always work to the closest value beneath and use that as its lookup value. What XLOOKUP lets you do is to go below or above to find the closest value that matches. I've got two examples here, one where we need to go down to find the closest match, one where we need to go up to find the closest match. So this first example is, let's say it's a post office. You take your parcel down the post office, put it on the scales. Based on the weight, they'll charge you a certain price for the postage. Now over here, we've got a starting weight of 225. And because we're trying to find a match in this lower weight range, we need to set it so it goes down to find the closest match. For the case of 225, it needs to pick up this range here to return $3 for the postage. Not go up to the closest, which will give you this one here, and therefore more expensive postage. So in this cell here, I'm going to start with equals XLOOKUP, and it might be clearer to look at it in the formula bar at the top here. So first of all, my lookup value is this 225, comma. The lookup array is this list of lower weight ranges, comma. And the return array is our list of prices just here. So here's our first three mandatory arguments. Now, if you look at the optional arguments over here, the if not found, we're going to ignore. What we want to get to is the match mode. So what we do here is we put two commas to move across to the bit that says, okay, what sort of match mode do you want to do? You can read the descriptions here, but what I want to do is to put a minus one, which is the exact match or the next smaller item. So I can either double click this, or type it in directly, close the bracket, and we're done. So the price there is $3. Always worth testing the breakpoints. So if we go 299, that's still in the same weight range. If I change this to 300, that's still in the same weight range. But if I go to 301, that's now in the next weight range, which gives me 325 postage. The second table is all about boxing weights. So obviously in boxing, you can't picture a big guy against a small guy. They've got to be in the same weight category. So this time it's the upper weight range that we're interested in. So over here, let's say we've got someone that's 60 kilos. This table here is saying that anything up to 63, which includes that 60, is going to be a lightweight. So in the cell here, I'm going to start with equals XLOOKUP, open the bracket, pick up the 60 as the weight I'm checking, comma. We check the weights here as the lookup value. The return array is the weight category. Then again, I put comma, comma, one. And one represents the exact or the next highest match value. So when we press enter, it brings back lightweight. If we change the weight here to say 64, that's now in the next category up, which is welterweight. So that's an example where you can use the approximate match, but go down or up to find the closest value, which is very useful. The old way was a little bit restrictive, often had to contort the table to kind of fit that model. And finally, I want to show you this example where we have a two-way lookup. Now this could be done with a match index combination, but I'm going to use a concept that we saw on the second sheet here and do something really smart to get this job done. I've named a few things on this table already, so just to let you know what's happening here. The department choice I've named dept. This cell here that contains the country choice I've named country. The range at the top here has been labelled countries or named countries. And the labels down the side here have been named depths. And the bit in the table that contains the contact name has been named names. So when you name stuff, of course, references become absolute, but also the formula becomes easier to read. Now, before I write the formula here, let me just reduce this down a little bit so we've got some space to work with. And in this cell here, let me start by typing equals XLOOKUP, open brackets, specify the department that's currently selected, comma, and then our list of departments over here. So that's dept, comma, depths, comma, and then the whole name range just here. And close the bracket and press enter. And so what it's done is it's spilled, just like we did on this sheet over here, and it's brought back all the contacts for this particular department. So all the contacts, one for each of these countries. If we do the same thing over here, if I say equals XLOOKUP, open the brackets, specify this country as the currently selected country, the range of countries at the top, so see how it's got country, comma, countries, and then again, for the range that contains the information we want back, that's the whole name range just here, close the brackets and press enter. And in the same way that the department contacts spilled across, the country contacts have spilled downwards. I'm going to combine both of those formulas into one, and basically it's going to intersect. Where they intersect will give us the contact name for the country and the department. So in this cell here, here's what we do. I'm going to start by saying equals XLOOKUP, open the brackets, click, say, the department, and look for that within the department's list, comma, and then instead of specifying the whole of this name range, I'm going to insert a second XLOOKUP where I find a match for the country within this country's list, and then specify the whole name range. Finish with two closing brackets, one for the inner XLOOKUP and one for the outer XLOOKUP. Now what the inner XLOOKUP does, that's the second one, is it brings back the list of country contacts. So in effect, the outer XLOOKUP is dealing with one list of names here for the particular country. When we press enter, it brings back a contact, Bernadette Brucker. And if we check gadgets and US, that's this one here, it is Bernetta Brucker. And if we change the department here to something else, and the country here to something else, so now we're looking at whatchamacallits for Canada, which is over here. That's Crystal Chance, which is the name that's come back. And the formula actually works both ways. So if we decided to look for country within the countries list, and the range that we're looking at is like a subsection where the inner XLOOKUP looks up dept within a depths range against the whole names range, that also works. So it doesn't matter which way you do it, first then second or second then first, where they intersect, that's the contact we're interested in. For some of you watching this video, that may be a step too far, but the purpose of this video was to give you an express tour of how to use XLOOKUP, firstly at a very super basic level, but then show you some of the more advanced things that it can do. And it's actually very smart because of this spill technology that's built into the function. I hope you found some value somewhere in this video, whatever level you're currently at. If you have any comments or questions, please post those beneath this video. I look forward to reading those and responding to those. And until next time, I shall see you then.